Coming to the first important the plantation crop, as the name indicates, the big one, that is coconut. Okay? You might be knowing coconut is coconut belongs to family Araceae, or it is also called as palm. Okay, and its chromosome number is 20^32. That we have to remember. And the origin is Southeast Asia. The most important. And the another important point in case of coconut is coconut edible portion is also called as wet meat. Most of the time it is asked wet meat. You should not forget wet meat is related to coconut. And the endosperm is the edible portion. Botanically, the endosperm is the edible portion, and the wet meat, it is also called as wet meat. Okay, I was talking to you about coeophytes and heliophytes in the last class. Coconut is an heliotrophic or a heliotype. That means it loves sun, or it loves to be grown in a high temperature. And the optimum temperature for the coconut cultivation is 27°C. Usually, when we select the coconut palms for the seedlings for the transplanting, we need to select them according to the height and also girth of the plant. But 9 to 12 month old seedlings are generally transplanted. You must remember this point also. This is also very much important. 9 to 12 months. Okay. And the next important point is the inflorescence in case of all the palm, it is spadix. Okay, in case of all the palm species, it is spadix. And the fruit is fibrous drupe. Don't get confused with the fruits. Whereas here in case of coconut, it is drupe. Okay. And the hormone which is present in case of coconut water, it is also sometimes asked. And one of the important point, that is cytokinin. It is the hormone that is present in coconut water, that is cytokinins. Okay, cytokinins are usually present in the coconut water. Coconut water. And this is another important point is the koi percentage in coconut husk. If you see the coconut, the whatever koi we get, right, that is 70%. Other than the koi, we have some of the outer layering of the crop, but the koi percentage is 70%. Where do we use this koi? These koi are generally used in making cocoa peats and all those things. Okay, and coconut water has 94.5% of water. So the whole water doesn't contain purely 100% of H2O itself. It also contains other minerals and nutrients. So along with that, cytokinin is also one, and vitamin B is also one. And we also have the 94.5% of water. Okay, when we consider a crop, when we consider the coconut water, the 94.5% is pure water itself. And the mature nut have coir percentage of 30 to 40%. This is the difference you have to remember, the coir percentage in coconut husk and the mature coconut. If at all, if I consider a whole nut, then there will be a 30 to 40% of coconut coir. If I consider the outer only outer husk of the crop, outer husk of the nut, then it contains 70% of the coir. Okay, and Lacadive ordinary is generally suitable for ball copra making, and Lacadive micro is generally suitable for the oil extraction and bulk copra. This one Lacadive ordinary, whereas this Lacadive micro is suitable for bulk copra production. Okay, and the secondary growth is absent in stem and root. This is the major important question that is asked. The secondary branches are we cannot see the secondary branches in case of coconut. That is mainly because of it lacks the cambium. Okay, the cambium is the right answer. It lacks secondary. That is the major reason why the secondary growth we cannot see the secondary growth in case of coconut. The cambium and the absence of cambium is the major reason for the lack of secondary growth in case of coconut. Another important point that you have to remember in case of coconut is coconut basically has a major drawback or deficiencies in terms of boron. So whatever you see, the button shedding or a small nuts dropping down or a irregular shape of the nut or a drupe is mainly because of the boron. So the boron deficiency you have to remember. And the root wilt is transmitted by lacebug. You might have seen the lacebug. Lacebug is the only insect which lays naked eggs, right? So that is the vector for root wilt. Other than that, we have some more points to be added to this. Do remember. Coming to the commercial products. Okay, coming to the commercial products, we have milling copra and the bulk copra, right? So in case of milling copra, the moisture content is very much important. The moisture content in case of milling copra is 6%. You must remember this. Whereas the fully mature coconuts, the fully mature coconut has 45 to 55% of the moisture.
Sir, PPT is not visible.
Yeah, we don't have PPT for these points. Okay, I'm just saying you can please add on the points to your notes. Okay, these are the extra points which we don't have. Please, you make the notes in your
moisture percent and milling copra.
Yeah, I'm telling the same thing. Give me a second. Okay, here in case of moisture percentage, in case of milling copra, it is 6%. Okay, it's very much important question. Several times it has been asked. Okay, and whereas when compared to the fully mature nuts, If I harvest a nut today and if I estimate the moisture content, it will be around 45 to 50%, whereas the milling copra has 6%. So what is the difference there? The difference amount of moisture will be dried out. Okay, that is what we have to look into it when we go for a milling copra production.
Sorry, what is milling copra?
Yeah, I will tell you. Whereas in case of coconut, we have two types, bal copra and milling copra, right? Milling copra is the one copra which is used for your oil extraction. Okay, bal copra and milling copra are almost same. They're used for the oil extraction. Whereas your copra is the one copra which is generally used for your culinary purpose. Okay, the milling, the in detailed information about all these things is not required, but you just remember this. But for your information, I have said you, the milling copra is the one copra which is used for the oil purpose, oil extraction. That should have a moisture percent of 6%. Okay, whereas the fully mature nut has around 45 to 55% of moisture content. One point. Another important point you have to remember is you might be knowing the difference between toddy and a neera, right? Okay, toddy and a neera. Neera is an unfermented juice. Okay, whatever we extract from the inflorescence. One more question you have to point you have to remember is neera or a extraction of sap is generally done only by the spadix or from the inflorescence of the nut. In any palm, in case of this palm also, or in case of Palmyra palm also, it is exclusively done from the spadix. Okay, so when you collect the water from the spadix or when you collect the neera, it is an clear for unfermented juice. I can call it as a clear unfermented juice. Whereas the uncontrolled fermentation process takes place. If you leave the neera for 1 or 2 days more, then there will be an uncontrolled fermentation. I can call it as uncontrolled fermentation. This point is very much important. So this uncontrolled fermentation leads to the toddy formation. Okay, toddy is an uncontrolled fermented product of coconut or any palm. Okay, for that matter, that toddy has the alcohol percentage of 5 to 8%. Clear? You must remember this. Toddy is an uncontrolled fermented product from a palm, and it has an alcohol content of 5 to 8%. Okay, usually this toddy and neera has the major sugar called sucrose. Sucrose is the major sugar which is present. Okay, sucrose is the major sugar which is present in case of toddy. Sucrose is actually a reducing sugar, right? So this is a sugar which is readily available, which has a capacity to reduce itself. So that is the, it can able to oxidize, right? So that is the reason why it goes to the fermentation process if you leave for a further time. So the sucrose is the major sugar which is present in case of toddy and neera, and toddy is extracted from unopened spadix. You must remember this. There are several doubts on this because sometimes the option will be having an open spadix, a closed spadix.
Sir, uncontrolled spadix or spathe?
One minute.
Unopened spathe
and spadix are almost same. I'll say you one thing. If you consider an inflorescence, the outer covering of the inflorescence called as spathe. Okay, that outer covering of inflorescence called as spathe. The whole inflorescence itself botanically is a spadix. Clear? The outer covering of an inflorescence is just called as spathe. If you can see a coconut inflorescence, there will be a covering on the inflorescence, right? That covering is called as spathe. Okay, here we can say unopened inflorescence. That means unopened spadix is the right answer. Okay, so unopened spadix. I request you to please make them in a question and answer session because it breaks my chain to say these things. Okay, sorry for that. And I was saying about toddy, right? Toddy has an around 5 to 8% alcohol. You must remember this point also. And coming to the coconut oil, another important product which we extract using bal copra or milling copra, the coconut oil has around 65 to 75% of the oil. If you extract the coconut oil, the oil constituent of the coconut is around 65 to 75%. Okay, and the oil has the major source of lauric acid. You might be knowing this. Lauric acid is the major source in case of coconut oil, and it is having around 65 to 75%.
सर कौन सा एसिड बोले
लॉरिक एसिड LAURIC लॉरिक एसिड ओके दिस वेरी मच इंपॉर्टेंट
कितना परसेंट होता है सर
75 टू लॉरिक एसिड परसेंटेज 65 टू 75%
सर बाल कोबरा दैट मॉइस्चर कंटेंट इज व्हाट सर
इन केस ऑफ बॉइल कोबरा वी डायरेक्टली बॉइल कोबरा और मिलिंग कोबरा और कप कोबरा दे आर डिफरेंट राइट बॉल कोबरा एंड मिलिंग कोबरा आर ऑलमोस्ट सेम दे आर जनरली कॉल्ड फॉर ऑयल एक्सट्रैक्शन इटसेल्फ राइट वी यूज कोबरा इज जनरली फॉर ऑयल एक्सट्रैक्शन इट आल्सो हैज अ 5 टू 6% एक्सेप्ट द कप कोबरा कप कोबरा हैज अराउंड 45 टू 55% ऑफ द मॉइस्चर नॉट इन द बॉल कोबरा एंड द मिलिंग कोबरा दे हैव द 5 टू 6% ऑफ मॉइस्चर इट्सेल्फ अनदर टू पॉइंट्स आई जस्ट वांट टू से या Other important two points are, you must remember the stem of the coconut where it joins to the root. You might have seen the root portion and the stem portion where you have a bulge portion in the root. That bulge portion near the stem and the root region is called as bole. Okay, if you come across any word called bole, then it is related to coconut. Coconut stem and the root region where we join that. We have a bulge portion, right? That is called as bole. And the top is called as, where the bottom is called as bole, where the top is called as cabbage. Okay, don't get confused. If there are words called cabbage and bole, they are related to the coconut also. The top portion with the leaves, they are called as cabbage. If you see on the top in the drone view, then you can clearly know it looks like a cabbage, so it is called as cabbage. Okay, so on the bottom portion, it is called as bole. Other important point is, in case of coconut, the first hybrid was released in the year 1937 by Patel, okay, P-A-T-E-L Patel, okay, in the year 1937. The crosses between these two are WCT into CGD, okay, WCT into West Coast Tall into Chowghat Green Dwarf. Usually, dwarf palms are used as a male parent, okay, usually dwarf plants are generally used here. But here in this case, dwarf is used as a male parent, okay? And the first hybrid was developed in the year 1937 and by Dr. Patel, okay? And the hybrid is WCT into CGD, Chowghat Green Dwarf, okay? And yesterday I had a question in a queries. I told tomorrow we will discuss. Someone has asked me the prefix for Kalpa and Kera, they have asked. Kalpa is released from CPCRI. Anything which are released from Kalpa is CPCRI, same as Kusandaka. Here anything which are released from CPCRI, they give you a prefix as Kalpa. And anything which are released from Kerala Agriculture University, they give it as Kera. Okay. Kera, wherever you find Kera, they have a female parent WCT. Okay, in most of the cases, that also you can remember because there are n number of hybrids in case of coconut. Remembering their parentage is very much difficult. For your easiness, I am saying one thing. In case of, if you find a Kera, for example, if you find a Kera Shri, okay, then you can clearly say the female parent is WCT. You can go for the first parent as WCT, and male parent you have to mug up and buy her. Okay, I am not saying you all the parentage in case of all the coconuts because it becomes heavy for you. If you are interested, you can get to your any of the notes. But important variety or a hybrid that I told you, the first hybrid which was developed in the 1937 by Patel, okay, crossing the tall into dwarf. If someone asks you about the parentage was the first hybrid parentage, means if they don't give a parentage, then they give a tall into dwarf, then you must be able to say, because WTC is a tall, whereas a CGD is a dwarf one.
So name of the hybrid?
So the name of the hybrid, they some say it is Kera Shankara also, but there are no name actually given for that. That is the first hybrid, but some say that is Kera Shankara also. Okay, Kera Shankara is also given to the name. Kera, I was saying, you're right, the first female will be always female, parent will be a WCT, so it goes with the Kera Shankara also. And there are another two hybrids that you have to remember. Just tell the parentage also, they're quite important. One coconut variety that you have to remember, that is Ganga Bundam. Okay, Ganga Bundam is the one variety that is particularly for the tender nut. Okay, among the different cultivars grown, the exclusive variety for tender nut is Ganga Bundam. Okay, and other than Ganga Bundam, there is a one more called COD, Chowghat Orange Dwarf. Usually, dwarf cultivars are named after the color of the nut. We have orange color, we have yellow color, we have green color. These are the major dwarf colors yielding palms. Among them, Ganga Bundam and COD are the best palms for the tender nut. And then we have one more disease called root wilt. We were talking about root wilt, right? Because it will be transmitted by lace bugs. So that root wilt resistant variety, you can really remember Kalparaksha. As the name indicates, raksha means resistant. So the root wilt resistant crop is Kalparaksha. Okay. The one more variety you must remember, Chandra Shankara. As the name indicates, Chandra means COD, okay, Chowghat, Orange, Dwarf into Shankara. Shankara means there will be a parentage of WCT. So the male parentage here is WCT. Okay, Chandra, Shankara, COD into WCT. There are several hybrids. That's what I was saying you. If at all there is a Kera Shri, okay, then what I said, Kera means the female parent will be WCT, right? WCT into MYD, Malayan Yellow Dwarf. Okay, that is the parentage of Kera Shri. whereas we have other variety called Kera Saubhagya. Once again, the female parent is the WCT, whereas the male parent is SSAT, straight settlement, okay, tall. That is the one variety. Then we have one more variety which is resistant to root wilt along with Kalpashri, Kalparaksha, sorry. Along with the Kalparaksha, we have one more variety which is resistant to root wilt, that is Kalpashankara. Okay, Kalpashankara. Here in case of Kalpashankara, the parentage are CGD into WCT. You can easily remember this, how the first hybrid was crossed between WCT into CGD. The same parentage, if you make
it CGD into...
Yeah, I'm saying. The first parentage was, the first hybrid was WCT into CGD, right? If you talk about Kalpashankara, right? Yeah, Kalpashankara, that is resistant to root wilt. And one more thing I was saying is Kalpashankara is a cross between CGD into WCT. That's what I was saying. The first hybrid was WCT into CGD, right? Crossed in the year 1937 by Patel. The same parentage, if you reverse it becomes Kalpashankara. So the Kalpashankara is resistant to root wilt. Okay, and it is prevalent to be grown in the root wilt prune areas. This is all about the major importance in case of coconut. If you remember this enough. And one more thing you have to remember is, whereas tall palms and dwarf palm you might be knowing, they are scientifically called as Coccus nucifera variety typica, whereas the dwarf one more called as Coccus nucifera variety nana. Okay, the tall variety is called as typica, whereas dwarf variety is called as nana, and that you have to remember. The age span also you have to remember, the age span of tall variety will be around 60 years, the lifespan or economic lifespan of a tall variety 60 years, whereas the dwarf variety is 35 to 40 years or 30 to 30, 35 years. That is what you have to remember. Okay. This is all about the coconut. If I come to the next important crop, that is Arakanut. In case of Arakanut, we have some important aspects. That is, Araka catechu is a monoecious palm cross-pollinated by honeybee. Most of the palms are monoecious. Okay, they are monoecious palms. Most of the palms are monoecious in nature. Okay, that means what is monoecious?
Sir, slides in unvisible.
Yeah. What is dioecious?
Sir, both male and female
are present in the same palm.
Okay, they are present in the same palm or same inflorescence, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah, that is monoecious, and you might be knowing the difference type. You have to clear enough all the basic terminologies. Okay. And coming to the Arakanut, that's a monoecious, and coconut is also monoecious. That means individual spadix has both male and female. Whereas, your information, the upper portion of the inflorescence will be showing the female flower, whereas the lower portion will be having the male flower. Okay. Is what, and the other important point is, it is single seeded berry. What does it mean? For example, in case of coconut, it is a drupe, right? But as Arakanut, it is a single seeded berry. Don't get confused. From the palms, Arakanut is a single seeded berry. Okay, whereas other palms like pomegranate palm, or maybe in case of oil, right? Oil palm, it is drupe. Oil palm, pomegranate palm, and then the coconut, they are drupe except the Arakanut. Arakanut is a single seeded berry. Among the palms which has a single seeded berry is Arakanut. Then we have the spacing, that's very much important. Spacing in case of Arakanut is around 2.7 meters. Okay, or else if it is given in the feet, then 9 by 9. Okay, if you can convert them, you can directly make out this, but if you remember this is very important, 2.7 to 2.7. There are few varieties in case of Arakanut, very important varieties that you have to remember. Most of them are introduced varieties. Okay, first variety Mangala. Okay, that Mangala, it is also called as VTL3. Okay, I have given here. Now Mangala is called a VTL3, which is released from China. Mangala is the VTL3 variety, which is introduced from China, not released. Sorry, it was introduced from China. Okay, remember that Mangala. Mangala variety was also called as VTL3, and it is introduced from China. And the next variety is Sumangala. It is VTL11. Okay, Sumangala is VTL11. Remember the name. Okay, Sumangala is VTL11, which is introduced from Indonesia. Sumangala is VTL11 introduced from India, whereas Mangala is VTL3 introduced from China. Then we have one more variety called Shrimangala, VTL17. okay, VTL 17, which is introduced from Singapore. VTL 17, Singapore, that is Sri Mangala. Okay. These are the other important varieties are Srivardhana, Swarnamangala, Mohit Nagar. Among them, you must remember the Mohit Nagar is particularly for West Bengal region. Okay, the variety which is suitable for West Bengal region is Mohit Nagar, whereas the variety which is suitable for Assam region, okay, for the Assam region is Kaikuchi. Okay, you must remember the name, that is Kaikuchi. And then we have one more, that is Sirsi Arakanet, selection 1, Cal 17, Cal 7, don't get confused with the word Cal, it comes under Arakanet. And then Tirthahalli, South Canara, Vittal Arakanet Hybrid 1. There are two hybrids. Those two hybrids we have to remember. One is Vittal Arakanet Hybrid 1, VTLAH1 and VTLAH2. Okay. Vittal Arakanet Hybrid 1 and Hybrid 2. Vittal Arakanet Hybrid 1 is crossed between Hirayalli Dwarf into Sumangala. The parentage of this is Hirayalli Dwarf into Sumangala. Okay, the parentage of the Vittal Arakanet Hybrid 1 is Hirayalli Dwarf into Sumangala, whereas VTLAH2, its parentage are, once again the female parentage is Hirayalli Dwarf crossed with Mohit Nagar. Okay, you must remember these two parentage. Okay, one is the Vittal Arakanet Hybrid 1 and Hybrid 2, one is crossed between Hirayalli Dwarf into Sumangala. Okay, Sumangala is VTL11, which is introduced from, Sumangala is introduced from Indonesia, right? Whereas VTL2 is Hirayalli Dwarf into Mohit Nagar. Coming to the other important aspects in case of Arakanet, that is various products.
From Karnataka introduction.
Hirayalli Dwarf is generally grown in Karnataka, it is not an introduced one. Okay, Mohit Nagar and Hirayalli Dwarf, they are not introduced, they are basically from Karnataka. I am talking about Mangala, Sumangala, Sri Mangala. These are the introduced varieties and they are renamed by that name. Okay. VTL.
Sir, Assam suitable varieties.
Assam suitable for Assam. Clear? And then we have different products. Okay. These products very much important. You must remember them. Every product. We have Chali, it's called as Kotta. We have Kalifok. Okay. I'll just name them first. Then we'll get into it. It's basic aspects is very much important. And then we have all these things, Breda grades. Okay, these grades are also very much important, like Mohit Nagar, Jam Nagar, Jinni. These are the grades in case of Arakanet. If someone asks you about the grades, you must be clear enough to say these are the grades. Okay, then coming to the most important thing is this difference between Chali and the Kotapak. That is very much very regularly asked and very important question also. Okay, in case of Chali or Kotapak, These are generally harvested. Kotapak is generally harvested at the stage of 8 to 9 months stage old. That means fully mature stage. The fully mature stage is called as Chali or Kotapak. Chali is nothing but the water that is used to coat the coconut, Arakanet. They boil it once again and they put the Arakanet seeds into the same thing. So it becomes a Chali or a Kotapak, fully mature. Okay. Whereas in case of Kalipak, it is a semi-processed one, I could call it as, or else we can also say that these are harvested at a month of 6 to 7 months. Okay. 6 to 7 month old nuts are used to prepare Kalipak, whereas 8 to 9 months old are used for preparation of Chali or Kotapak. Okay. Then we have one more word called, If you cut open this Arakanet, then we can call them as neat adaka. Okay, and the cut water preserved nuts are called as neat adaka. Okay, this is also important. Water preserved nuts are called as neat adaka. And talking to the grades, these are the different grades in case of Chali or Kotapak. I was saying about the Chali and Kotapak, the mature nuts, right? So after they are harvested, and these are the grades: Moti, Srivardhan, Jamnagar and Jinni. These are grades based upon the place they have standardized, and these are the place of grades of Chali or Kotapak. Yeah, these are the grades for Chali and Kotapak. We have one more important point here in case of Arakanet, that is the major pest is spindle bug or Kolaroga, that you must remember. Kolaroga or Mahila, that is caused by Phytophthora and MLOs. This is one point. Other species is the Araka triandra. This is very much important species that you have to remember, that was identified in Mysore. Okay, but what is the special character of Araka triandra? That is suckering habit. Okay, it has a suckering habit, so we can grow Araka as a ornamental purpose. The ornamental areca is areca triandra. Okay, this areca triandra is ornamental purpose, and Concinia is also an ornamental purpose. These two are also the ornamental purpose. The ornamental species in case of areca, areca triandra and areca Concinia, both have the suckering habit. Okay, triandra has a red color nuts, whereas Concinia has the scarlet red color. Okay. There are few more species in case of areca catechu. These are not the areca catechu. These are areca triandra. The species is changed, but there are four species in case of areca catechu itself. For your information, areca catechu variety communis, areca catechu variety silvatica, botanensis, and longicarpa. You must just remember these are the types of areca. Okay. One important point you have to remember is this point. Okay, this is very much about 35 gram weight of areca is used for the propagation. So the nut weight and the nut characteristics is very much important that you have to remember. Okay, one more point I have forgot to say in case of coconut is that in case of coconut, the planting of a seedling at horizontal stage, or that means what I want to say is the planting the coconut seedling in a horizontal stage gives the better growth compared to the vertical growth. Okay, if you want to plant a seedling today, if you want to go for a seedling of coconut, then you need to plant it in a horizontal position. So there are I have seen the questions asking which position gives the better seedling rate. That is horizontal. That is simple, because the growing embryo receives the water which is present. The water inside the coconut is called as endosperm, right? So that, what is the role of endosperm? The major role in any crop is nourishing the embryo. The growing embryo, it has to nourish, right? It need to give some energy to the growing embryo. So this endosperm helps in giving the energy to the growing embryo. In the same way, when you place the coconut droop in a horizontal position, then the water inside the endosperm will easily available to the growing embryo, so that the plant comes up well. When you plant in a vertical position, so the embryo receives the lower amount of endosperm or the lower amount of the water which is present inside, right? That is a major. You have to remember, growing horizontally is best when compared to the vertical growing in case of coconut. Okay. In case of Araucanut is highly susceptible to sun scorching. Okay. The seedlings are highly susceptible to sun scorching. So growing them in the north-south direction is better. Okay. Yeah, there are some. I have seen the questions. They have asked that growing in which direction gives the best. That is north-south direction. If I say north-south direction you need to grow, then which direction we need to avoid? Southwestern directions we need to avoid. We need to avoid southern-western positions in case of planting, so that the sun rays falls on the plant is reduced and the sun scorching will be reduced. So you need to plant Araucanut in a north-south direction. Okay. Then we have one more important disorder. You must remember the disorder that is called as nut splitting. Have you heard about the term nut splitting? The nut splitting is majorly due to the problem of two major nutrients. One is potash, another one is boron. Okay, so you must remember, not only boron, nut splitting happens also due to the potash. Okay, so the potash deficiency leads to the nut splitting, and also the boron deficiency leads to the nut splitting. These are the major two components which are responsible for the nut splitting in case of Araucanut. Coming to its two more important characters related to its donors or related to its breeding. Okay, just remember, make a point, but not so much important. Okay, for a high yielding purpose, Areca catechu is generally preferred among the species because it gives a higher yield. For early bearing, you can go for Areca catechu variety Mangala, but generally Mangala is not preferred in the market. Areca catechu early bearing type is Mangala one. Okay, and then if you want to go for greater number of fruits per bunch, for example, for a one bunch, if you have to have a more number of fruits, then or a more number of berries, then you can go for Teerthahalli. Okay, so you can say that these are all the donors. If you are going for a breeding purpose, for a higher yield, for a higher nut or a higher greater number of nuts, then you can go for these varieties. Teerthahalli is for greater number of nuts. Okay, and this is very much important point. For a better quality, the Araucanut for a better quality, that is Srivardhana. Okay, you must remember the name Srivardhana. Srivardhana variety is for better quality. The variety suitable for better quality is Srivardhana. Okay, and for suckering habit, as I said, that it is Areca triandra. play. This all is the major important
greater aspect. Number of greater number of nuts in which variety?
Yeah. Greater number of nuts in which variety? That is Tirthahalli. Okay, Tirthahalli. Araka Katacho cultivar Tirthahalli. Tirthahalli is a place in Karnataka. So Tirthahalli is better for the nuts. These are the local cultivars which are selected but have a better quality. But still they are grown. Okay. Clear? Araka Katacho cultivar Tirthahalli. This is all about the Arakanut and coconut. Okay. Then we have one other important palm. That is oil palm. Okay, let's listen to oil palm. Oil palm, Ilias guineensis, is now a crop for future. Okay, it is small holder irrigated crop. Why it is called as crop for future? That means nowadays this oil is considered as one of the best oil. Okay, when compared to other oils. Okay, this is the crop for future and a small holder irrigated crop. That means it required a high amount of water for the growth and cultivation. Among different palms or among the different oil yielding crops, oil palm is the one which has the highest amount of oil yielding. Okay, it has highest amount of oil yielding. So you can say the best oil yielding crop is the oil palm. Ilias guineensis is the scientific name. The family and the chromosome number you have to keep in your tongue. That is 32 and belongs to family palm. Coming to its origin, it is originated in West Africa, and this is very much important point. Oil palm was introduced to India in Tolofusa. Okay, it was introduced in India in Tolofusa in the year 1960. So oil palm is an introduced crop. It is not a basic Indian origin crop, and it was introduced to India in Tolofusa in the year 1960. NRCOP means now it has changed into Directorate of Oil Palm Research. It has not a NRC now, it is Directorate now. That is Pedavagi in AP. Okay, you must remember this one also. All the research institutes of all the horticulture stations, that you must remember, that is the mandatory things. There may be a questions coming from this sector, institution names or the location, you must remember them, right? That is NRC is now renamed as Directorate of Oil Palm Research, that is located in Pedavagi in Andhra Pradesh. Okay, one important. Another important, very important point is this one. You must remember the pollination. Okay, oil palm pollination is specially done by the common weevil called Elidobius tamarinicus. Okay, remember the name of the weevil. So the oil palm weevil is generally the weevil pollinated plant as of now known is the oil palm. So the oil palm weevil is Elidobius tamarinicus. Okay, I was saying you that coconut palms are around 9 to 12 months old, they are generally transplanted, right, from nursery to the field, whereas in case of Arakanut it is around 10 to 18 months olds are generally transplanted, whereas in case of oil palm it is 10 to 14 month old seedlings are transplanted, are used for propagation. That means they are generally transplanted from the nursery to the main field. We have three different types that you might be knowing. One is Dura, Piscifera and Tenera. The major difference is Dura is a thick shelled, Piscifera is a shellless, whereas Tenera is the hybrid. Okay, among these three, this is the basic known information, but the important factor you have to remember is among these three, Dura is used as a mother palm. In your hybrid program, the mother parent in case of hybrid hybridization is Dura. Dura is generally used as the mother palm. Okay, whereas the Piscifera is generally used as the pollen parent. Okay, the Piscifera is generally used as a pollen parent. It is shellless, but it is used as a pollen parent. Why it is used as a pollen parent? It has the special character of the female infertility. Okay, it has infertility cases, so there will be no female flowers. So there will be very less amount of female flowers or female structures in the flower. So it is used as a pollen parent. The pollen parent in oil palm breeding is Piscifera. Okay, Piscifera. Whereas these types are Pisciferas are generally used for the breeding purpose only. They are not common. Not commonly grown. Okay. They are not commonly grown. The generally or most commonly grown oil palm are Tenera types. Okay. Tenera are generally grown. Clear? These are the three points you must remember. Dura, Piscifera and Tenera. One is thick shelled, another one is shellless, another one is hybrid, right? It is crossed between Dura and Piscifera. So one is used as the mother parent, one is used as a female parent, sorry, one is a pollen parent, another one is used as a generally grown. The generally grown oil palm in the country now, what we see is, it's called as Canara. Another important aspect that you have to remember, very frequently asked question is the important cultural operation that is followed, that is ablation. You might have heard about the name called ablation. So the ablation is very much important. Okay. You must remember there's a word ablation. Ablation stands for removing of the inflorescence, okay? Removing or pulling of the flowers in the early stages in order to enhance or in order to give boost to the plant. It is done up to 3 years, okay? All the flowers in the plant has to be removed by hand, okay? All the flowers in the plant has to be removed by hand up to 3 years, and the process is called as ablation. Removing of inflorescence or deprowning of the inflorescence called as ablations, clear? And usually,
sir, up to how many years, sir? Ablation?
3 years. Up to 3 years. THREE. Okay. 3 years. Up to 3 years, we need to go for ablation process. Ablation is generally followed in oil palm, and it is done up to 3 years. After 3 years, we will be releasing our wonder weevil, that is Elidubius camarenicus. After 3 years. Okay. Okay. Then one more important aspect in case of oil palm you have to remember is the oil palm is highly processed crop. That means you cannot directly go for the direct consumption, or you cannot directly use it as an edible oil, right? You need to go for the processing. So that processing aspect has to be carried out within a few hours of harvest. So at most maximum within a 24 hours of harvest. Okay. So why it has to be processed? Because the enzyme lipase directly deteriorates the oil quality. Okay. So in order to deteriorate the oil quality, we need to process it as soon as possible. The enzyme responsible for deterioration is lipase. Okay. Lipase is the enzyme responsible for deterioration. And one more point I want to say you, important point. Oil palm is 3 times more the oil of coconut. If I say coconut is yielding 10%, then oil palm yields the more oil of 30 times of coconut. So I can say that three times more of coconut, just for your information, and it's important also. Okay, and then it is seven times more of rapeseed. It's also one of the important oil crop, right? And the 10 times more of soybean. You can just estimate. Imagine how much high yielding this palm is. So it yields more, 3 times more the oil of coconut. It yields 7 times more the oil of rapeseed, and 10 times more the oil of soybean. And this oil has a very good character, that rich in beta carotene. Okay. The oil rich in beta carotene is the oil palm oil. So you have to remember, the oil palm oil has rich in beta carotene. Okay. It is very much important. And the major, another important point you have to remember is the processing steps. As I was saying, with the chain, right? You must remember the chain of processing. Here, immediately after harvest, we go for extraction of the oil in an extractors, and then we go for refining, and then we go for fractionization. Okay, all these terminologies is not much more important. But why it has done, you have to remember. Extraction is the first process. Okay. Extraction is generally done to inactivate the lipase. Okay, lipase or the lipase enzyme. It is generally done to inactivate the lipase or lipase enzyme and to loosen the punches. The next second step is the refining. Okay, and the next step is sterilization. Sterilization step is very much important. Sterilization is very much important. It's done for 60 minutes. Okay. 60 minutes at 45 degree. This is very much important. You must remember, sterilization is done in case of oil palm in order to regulate the enzyme activity. So it stops the enzyme activity. It is done at 60 minutes at 45 degree Celsius. Okay. Done for 60 minutes at 45 degree Celsius. Then if you find any terminology called FFB, then don't get confused. They are related to oil palms. Okay. FFB, that is fresh fruit bunches. fresh fruit bunches. When you harvest the bunch, they are generally called as FFBs, that is fresh fruit bunches. Don't get confused with the word that is related to oil palm. This is the major importance in case of oil palm. And one more point I want to say, here in case of oil palm, we have two types of oil. Okay, we have two types of oil. One is the pulp oil, another one is the kernel oil. Even the kernel, that means it is a drupe, right? It has a kernel inside. So the kernel also have a oil. The kernel oil is rich in lauric acid. It yields around 2%. If you harvest a 100 kg of an oil, the kernel oil is around 2%, 2 kg. Okay. So that 2% of oil is rich in, once again, the lauric acid. Okay. The lauric acid is the major one. Clear? The palm oil is, the palm oil has two types of oil. One is the kernel oil and the palm oil. Palm oil is rich in palmitic acid, whereas the kernel oil is rich in lauric acid. Okay, clear? Palm oil is rich in case of palmitic acid, whereas the kernel oil is rich in lauric acid. And the kernel oil yield is around 2%. Okay. The remaining everything will be from the pulp or from the palm. We can call it as palm oil. I was talking about Elaeus guineensis, right? The Elaeus guineensis is the African oil palm. As the name indicates, it is originated in Africa. There is one more palm, oil palm called as Elaeus oleifera. Okay? That is an American oil palm, Elaeus oleifera. So don't get confused, an African oil palm is Elaeus guineensis, whereas the American oil palm is Elaeus guineensis. Clear? With this, we complete oil palm, then we head into another small palm, that is Palmyra palm. Okay. Here in case of Palmyra palm, we have a few points to be remembered. Okay. As I was saying that almost all the palms are monoecious in nature, whereas the Palmyra palm is, the differentiating character is dioecious in nature. One point. Okay. And the second important point is Palmyra palm chromosome number is 36. All others had 32 chromosome number, where Palmyra palm inflorescence is around 30. Palmyra palm inflorescence is around 36. And it is generally called as state tree of Tamil Nadu. It was announced that it is the state tree of Tamil Nadu. And it is also called as Kalpagatara. Okay. It is also called as Kalpagatara, the tree of life.
Sir? Kalpagatara
means, yes, please.
So Palmyra is a triploid?
No. It has been written something wrong here, probably. It is 2N is equal to. Okay. It is also originated in tropical Africa. Okay, it is called as Kalpagatara or a tree of life. It is also called as tree of life. Don't get confused. Tree of life. Whereas coconut is called as Kalpataru. Okay, it is Kalpagatara. Okay, it is a state tree of Tamil Nadu and dioecious palm, Borassus familifer. There are different species. Remember the one species. And another important point you have to remember is, this is three-seeded drupe. I was talking to you about single-seeded berry, right? That is Araucanut, whereas this palm is three-seeded drupe. If you look into a Palmyra palm, you can see three different sections, that is three-seeded drupe, originated in tropical Africa, dioecious. There is only one variety, that is Srivalliputtur. Yes, P-R-1 is called as Srivalliputtur. That is the one variety. And these are the important products. We will look into this. This is very much important. And one word we have to see it, tending. Okay. Tending is very much important in case of Palmyra palm as ablation in case of oil palm. If the tending means removal of leaf base. For example, if you harvest the fruit, or if you harvest the bunch, or if you harvest the inflorescence for Nira study, every year there will be a leaf fall, right? So that leaf fall, sometimes it breaks. So tending, that means removing the leaf bases which are on the trunk of the palm, is very much important. That is called as tending. The word tending is related to Palmyra palm. Okay. Coming to its major importance, that is the processing aspects. As I was telling you in case of coconut, the same thing holds good here also. We have Nira, we have toddy, and we have arax. Okay, this Nira is a transparent fluid or a pleasant smelling, sweet smelling. Okay, this you have to remember. Nira is a transparent, pleasant, sweet smelling. Okay, it is non-fermented or it is unfermented. It is not a fermented product. okay, and it has a pH of around 7.2. This is very much important. Nira has a pH of around 7.2. Nira pH is very much important, 7.2, and it has a sucrose content of, sucrose is the major sugar, sucrose is the major sugar which has around 10 to 12%. Okay, sucrose is the major sugar, so it has 10 to 12%. As I was saying you, right, this is the reducing sugar, so it has a property to get fermented. Okay, it can easily be, what is the if you bifurcate sucrose, what we get glucose plus fructose, right? So these glucose plus fructose are the major source for the fermentation. Fermentation is generally is an uncontrolled process. So in case of Palmyra also, uncontrolled fermentation is seen. Uncontrolled fermentation that leads to toddy. Okay, whereas this toddy is generally prepared, or generally this toddy has been the things I mean to say, the uncontrolled fermentation is taken place by the help of bacteria, some unknown bacteria, any bacteria which are in the inflorescence or in the pot, they leads to the fermentation of this toddy, because they take sucrose as their food material and they make it into alcohol. So toddy is a fermented product. pH is very much important, and the sucrose content is very much important. Another point in case of toddy is it has 5% of alcohol. Okay, it has 5% of alcohol. Toddy has 5% of alcohol. And then we have one more that is called Palmyra arak. Okay, arak is nothing but toddy is used to generally prepare the araks. Araks, that means they are distilled. The toddy is distilled, refortified, and it has a higher amount of alcohol percent. Arak has around 10% alcohol. Arak has 10% alcohol, okay, not a 1%, 10%.
Sir, how arak is prepared?
Okay, arak is generally prepared by still distillation. So once you get the toddy is still distilled. So it is further more distillation is done. Once the distillation is done, we get a potable alcohol. Okay, that means a alcohol with a higher, a toddy with a higher amount of alcohol after distillation. So that is called as the arak. Okay, Palmyra arak, it has 10% of alcohol. One more important point you have to remember is all this terminology is very important. Tattu pani, kavi vettu, vallu pani, aripanai. These are very much important. For your information, I will say you in which form they are done. Okay, aripani, let me take the aripani. Among the different types of tapping systems, what are these? These are the tapping systems. I can call it as tapping. What is tapping? Extraction of sap from the inflorescence is called as tapping in general, right? So the extraction of inflorescence from the palm is called as tapping. So tapping can be called as tattupani, kavivettu, vallupani and aripani. These are some terminologies given for the extraction of the palm fluid or a palm sap or inflorescence sap. So this aripalani is generally followed in, as I have written here, it is generally followed in male plants. Okay, aripalani is exclusively followed in case of male plants, and vallupalani is also followed in case of male plants. So clear, aripalani and vallupalani are followed in case of male plants. Okay, whereas the aripalani is done immediately after 2 weeks of the inflorescence. That means the 2 weeks old inflorescence we use for aripalani. Aripalani we use 2 weeks old inflorescence. This is the important one, the differentiating factor. In case of aripalani, we use 2 weeks old inflorescence, whereas in case of vallupalani, we use 1 month old inflorescence. Inflorescence will be in the palm itself, right? So we go on tap it after 1 month. Okay, that is vallupalani. After 2 weeks, if you tap it, then it is aripalani. In case of kavivettu and in case of tattupalani, this is followed in case of female plants. Okay, that means in case of female palms, because we have differentiating nature in case of Palmyra, right? What is the differentiating nature? How can we differentiate male and female? It is a dioecious. It automatically produces two different. So once you tap from a vallupalani or from a male plant, then it may be a vallupalani or it may be aripalani. Once you tap from a female plant or a female palm, then it may be a tattupalani, tattupani or a kavivettu. These two are the different terminologies. Whereas in case of kavivettu, kavivettu is generally followed about 2 to 3 months inflorescence. 2 to 3 month old inflorescence, kavivettu is followed. Kavivettu is followed about 2 to 3 months inflorescence. Okay. And we don't have information about what stage or at what month Katsuparani is followed, but it is followed in female plants, female palms. Generally, tapping is done in the month of December to February. This also you have to remember, tapping is done in the month of December to February. And another important is Neera, I was talking you about. If someone say you about Padaneer, then you can confuse. Padaneer is a synonymous to Neera. Okay, this Neera is the richest source of vitamin C and D complex. So whenever you hear word called Neera or Padaneer, so Neera or Padaneer, okay, they have a B complex along with vitamin C. Okay, they are the richest source of B complex and vitamin C. This you might have even known in the coconut also. Coconut water is richest sort of cytokinins. They are the vitamin B complexes. They are also rich. They are not rich in case of vitamin C, but here in case of Pamaira Neera is rich in case of vitamin C. And I have even forgotten to say you, coconut water is also richest source of potassium. Okay, that is also richest source of potassium. Don't get confused. Then we have one terminology, don't get confused, okay, apicollum comes under Pamaira, the tubers. In case of Pamaira, the tubers are also edible, young tender tubers, okay, young tender tubers are edible in case of Pamaira, they are called as apicollum, okay, they are called as apicollum, they are generally in 3 month old. The young tender tubers of Pamaira palms are called as apicollum. They are generally 3 months old. Don't get confused with the word called nungu. Okay, if someone asks you about nungu, nungu is nothing but a tender fruit. Whatever we find outside in the market, whatever we eat in the market, they are nungu. That is a tender fruit. Nungu is a tender fruit. These all terminologies are related to Pamaira palm. This is much more important. Nungu is a tender fruit. Okay, what we consume in the market, that is tender fruit, whereas apicollum is a tender tuber of 3 month old. Then we have one more terminology called palm cola. Okay, as the name indicates, palm cola means they are from Pamaira palm. Okay, cola means, what is cola actually? What is Coca-Cola? It is an aerated drink, right? That means it has been aerated. It has been mixed with the additional amount of CO2. That is nothing but an aeration, right? So the aerated drinks, it contains 11% sugar. Okay. 11% sugar plus citric acid. Okay, palm cola is an aerated drink from Pamaira palm, contains 11% sugar and a citric acid. It is an aerated drink. The aerated drink from Pamaira palm is palm cola. Clear? This all about the basic information about the oil palm, Pamaira palm, coconut, and the another one is Arakan, right? These are about the major importance in case of Palmaceae family. These are the major important palms, and you have to remember this. Okay, I will share this information. This one, you can go through them once, or you can go back to the lessons or to the revisions of this. And next, we have another important one crop. We'll go through rubber later on. First, we will finish it off coffee. Okay, we'll come into the beverage crops first, and then we'll go on to the rubber commercial crops. Not much more importance here in case of coffee and other crops. Okay. As you all know, coffee is called as king of beverages. We have two types. One is coffee arabica and coffee robusta. Belongs to family Rubaceae. There is one more type also called, that is tree coffee, coffee liberica. You also remember that is a source of richest source of your resistance for other pest and diseases. Okay, Coffea liberica. Okay, so the Coffea arabica and Coffea robusta are the two major cultivated species. Yeah, two major cultivated species. And this point you all know, it is an second most important commodity in the world. It is originated in Ethiopia. Okay, it was introduced in Chikmagalur district of Karnataka by a Muslim pilgrimage. You all know that coffee is a short day, pollinated by wind and bees. It is a two-seeded drupe. Don't get confused. Yesterday I was saying you that every time coffee is called as berry, 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 right? So it will be in your mind that coffee is botanically berry. No, coffee is botanically a drupe. Okay, don't get confused. Coffee is botanically a drupe. It is two-seeded drupe. Okay. And then we have self-pollination in case of Arabica palms, Arabica plants, and then cross-pollinated in case of palm, robusta palms. Okay, and if you find a single berry, see here, these are all the defects or these are all the drawbacks in coffee cultivation. In I was saying about two-seeded drupe, right? If you find a single drupe, if you find a single berry inside a drupe, then it is called as one ovule is aborted, that is P berry. Only one ovule formation will be there, so there is called as, then it is called as P berry. If there are more than one ovule, then there will be formation of two or three small berries or three or three small drupes inside that. So that is called as elephant bean. Okay, so that is called as elephant bean. As the name indicates, elephant is more, bean is less. Okay, coffee rust, scientific name is very much important, Hemelia rustatrix. Okay, and then weeding in coffee is cuffling. Cuffling is nothing but the uprooting the soil. Cuffling is word related to coffee, where the coffee soils are generally turned over in order to reduce the amount of weed. This is very much important. This is chicorium. Okay, chicorium, chicoria is, or chicory is generally called. Chicoria or chicorium is the general adulterant used in the coffee. Whatever you get in the market, an instant coffee, that doesn't include the pure coffee at all. Here though, includes around 70%, 80% of chicory, only 20% of coffee what you see. Okay, one more important point is the silver oak is the permanent shade tree. Okay, whereas dadap is called as temporary shade tree. Dadap, erythrina, right? Okay, that is dadap, that is erythrina. Dadap is also scientifically erythrina. Selective plucking in case of coffee is called as fly picking. Yesterday I was talking to you about something plucking in some product, no? So selective plucking in case of coffee is called as, or a picking in case of coffee is called as fly picking. One point you must remember, the instant coffees are generally prepared, that means whatever you get, brew and all those things, like Clevista and all, instant coffee is generally prepared from, instant coffee is generally prepared from robusta. Okay, don't get confused. Instant coffee is generally prepared from robusta. In India, highly grown coffee is also robusta. Okay, in India, the highly grown coffee is also robusta. The instant coffee is also prepared from the robusta. And the other important point is, in the world the highest coffee growing highly grown coffee is called Arabica. In the world they grow Arabica, but in India we grow robusta. Okay, the differences are very much important. You must remember the differences also, the difference between Arabica and robusta. Okay, if I want to say them, I can say you in one or two points, because it has very depth information about that, but that much information is not needed. But you just remember one thing, Arabica is autogamous, that is self pollinated, whereas robusta is cross pollinated. Okay, Arabica is suitable for higher elevation, robusta is suitable for lower elevation. How can you remember this? Robusta is robustic in nature, so it cannot go into a higher elevated crops because it may go for a toppling over, so it is suitable for the lower elevation, whereas Arabica is suitable for the higher elevation, a short structured plant, so it can go for the higher elevations. These are the two major important points you have to remember in case of Arabica and robusta. There are several varieties and crops selections. Yeah, the major difference between Arabica and Robusta is, Arabica coffee is generally suitable for the higher elevations. Higher elevations means higher altitude regions. That means in a higher zone you can grow them, because they are short structured, so they can manage in a higher elevated areas. So they are suitable for higher elevations, 1000 to 1500 mean sea levels. Okay, whereas in case of Robusta, they are suitable for the lower elevated areas with around 500 to 1000 MSL. One point. Okay, Arabica is a self-pollinated, whereas Robusta is cross-pollinated. Okay, Robusta is a cross-pollinated, Arabica is self-pollinated, autogamous, allogamous. Another important point I have forgotten is, Arabica is tetraploid in nature. Okay, you must remember this point. Arabica is tetraploid in nature, 2n is equal to 44. Okay, and this is easily you can remember. Whereas I was saying you that Arabica is a short structure. Even though it is a short structure, it is a tetraploid. Okay, it is a tetraploid. It has a chromosome number of 44. Whereas Robusta is a diploid. It is a robustic in nature, but even though it is a diploid, it has a chromosome number of 2n is equal to 12. Okay, there is one variety that you have to remember, that is HDT. HDT hybrido D-tomer. Okay, HDT. HDT. That is high Bredo dichomer. It is crossed between Kathura into, you might have studied this, okay. It is crossed between Kathura into hybrid, one minute, hybrid or tumor. Okay, look into it. Hybrid or tumor is actually basically a cross between Robusta into Arabica. That is a basic cross. If I get the exact parentage, I will say you, but I got confused. Okay. This is the major variety that is grown. Another important variety is, we have one variety called Kaveri, that is, that comes under Arabica type. Okay, remember the name of that, that comes under Arabica type. And I was talking to you about elephant berry, pea berry and all those things, right? There are two more terminologies that you have to remember, that is triage, okay. Triage, they are abnormal defective berries. Abnormal defective berries. Okay. Nothing is related. If I say berries, then it is nothing related to the botanical name because it is botanically a two-seeded group. Okay, I repeat once again. Then we have one more word called blacks. Okay. Blacks are nothing but the berries. The berries with 3-4 blackening. Okay, 3-4 blackening. The berries with 3-4 blackening are called as blacks. I am just saying you all these things because whatever terminology you get, you should not get confused. Okay, in which crop it comes. If we have talked about elephant berry, we have talked about pea berry, triages, and blacks. Okay. Coming to another important aspect, that is in case of coffee, that is harvesting. Okay. Harvesting a major importance, I will say you. One major importance. One is the parchment making, another one is the cherry making. What is parchment making? In case of parchment coffee, that is where we go for a pulping. What is pulping? We remove the outer layer of the coffee so that the two cotyledons will be broken up. Clear? That is the parchment. The two cotyledons will be broken up by removing the outer pellicle or the outer layer of the coffee drupe. Clear? That becomes the parchment. Whereas in case of cherry, the whole drupe will be dried in sun for a moisture content of 10-12%. This is very much important. Coffee drying moisture content 10-12%, and then they are sold. Clear? Whereas in case of parchment coffee, they are generally followed in Arabica. Arabica species are generally used for parchment making. That means we remove the pulp of the cover, that is called pulping. We remove the pulp and then we go for a fermentation to remove the mucilaginous coat over it. And once you remove the mucilaginous coat, you wash it and then we dry it. That is the parchment coffee. That is generally done in Arabica. In case of Robusta, we follow the cherry method, where what we do, we harvest the crop and we directly dry them and we directly sell them. That is Robusta. Clear? That is the cherry processing. And we have another two terminology. Moisture percent 10-12%. In all the coffee, it should be 10-12% only. Okay. More the moisture, then the lower the price. Okay. Coming to major, another difference I have forgotten between Arabica and Robusta is Arabica quality is superb. Arabica quality has a higher grade in compared to the Robusta, but the strong coffee flavor is in the Robusta. And compared to the Arabica. Arabica has a lower coffee flavor, but is a delicate coffee flavor, but it is also very pure. Whereas Robusta has a strong coffee flavor. That is why they are generally used in instant coffee powder making. And one more two terminologies in coffee you have to remember. One is stripping. I was talking to you about fly picking, right? Another one is stripping. Another one is glinning. Okay, we talked about scuffling. We talked about fly picking. Now we are talking about stripping and glinning. STRIPPING. What is stripping? Irrespective of the ripe, what we were doing in case of fly picking, we were picking only the ripe berries, right? Only the selective picking. We pick only the ripe berries. That is generally followed in the first round of harvest. We pick only the ripe berries from the bunch. That is called as fly picking, right? In the second picking, that is called as stripping. We strip out all the berries, all the drupes or berries from the bunch, and we take for the drying process. That is stripping. What is glinning then? G-L-E-N-I-N-G. What is glinning? Glinning is nothing but the collection of fallen berries. That means while harvesting, there will be a lot many not many berries that they fall down to the ground, right? We need to pick them out also. So that is called as glenning, G-L-E-N-I-N-G. That is glenning. We have talked about fly picking, we have talked about glenning, stripping, stuckling. Okay, all these terminologies are related to coffee. This is all about the coffee. Then we will head into the next important crop, that is cocoa. Okay, cocoa. Yeah, Coffea liberica is a wild species. You just remember, Coffea liberica is a wild species. Coffea canephora is a robusta. Coffea arabica is arabica. Coffea liberica is a wild species that is generally called as pre-coffee. Okay, it is not generally grown. It is generally used as an admixture to mix between these two. They are generally used. They are the richest source of the resistance source for Haemilobacter species, or it may be for other diseases and pests. One point. Okay. Coffea liberica. Another point you have to remember, robusta crop is highly resistant to most of the diseases and pests. Irrespective of the disease, irrespective of the pest, we have Haemilia vostraxit, we have shoot borer, we have berry borer, right? All these are the major diseases and pests in case of coffee. So robusta is resistant to the diseases and pests. Okay, arabica is highly susceptible to disease and pest. One more difference between these two. Okay, robusta is highly susceptible to robusta is highly resistant to diseases and pest, whereas arabica is highly susceptible to diseases and pest.
Sir, which coffee is our GI tag, sir? GI tag. Arabica
or robusta. Is generally grown, na?
No, Shota. So, if you have any more questions, I think it is better to put your questions in the Q&A section. Okay. So, at last, you will take a call for that. I think that will be fine.
Yes, sir. Okay. Then we have other important plantation crop, that is cocoa. Okay, cocoa belongs to family. It was named under a family called Sterculaceae. Okay, previously, but recently they have named it under Malvaceae family. Okay, don't get confused. If there is a Malvaceae also, then it belongs to family Malvaceae. Okay, cocoa belongs to family Sterculaceae. If at all you have an option called Malvaceae, it is renamed to the Malvaceae family. 2n is equal to 20. It is cross pollinated. Here you must remember the midges. Cytopogomids, midges are the pollinating agents. Okay, the midges are the pollinating agents. We have come across the weevils, and now we are coming across the midges. Midges are in case of cocoa. Theobroma cocoa, it is called as food of God, originated in Amazon Valley of South America. Okay, propagation is microbudding, and Kerala is a leading producer. One other important point you have to remember is the calcareous or cauliflorous bearing. Okay, that means the fruits are bared on the stem or on the portions of other than the leafy axils. Okay, they are bare on the stem portions. Okay, same example we have jackfruit also. Then these are the terminologies: fan, chupons and verticals. If I want to talk about the chupons and verticals and fan branches, the vertical stem is called as chupon. From the ground to the vertical stem is called as chupon, that is the continuous stem. Then we have jarpets. Okay, jarpets are nothing but the horizontal branches. Immediately after the stem, then we will be having an horizontal branch that is called as jarpet. Don't get confused. Jarpet word is related to cocoa, not in the tea. Some will get confused. Jarpets are related to cocoa. They are horizontal branches to the chupons. From the jarpet, we have tertiary branches. They are called as fan branches. Okay, they are also sometimes called as fan branches, jarpets also. But the original fan branches are the tertiary branches which originate from the jarpets. There are three different types of cocoa, right? You might be knowing. One is Theobroma cocoa, Criollo, Forestro and Trinitario. There are three types of cocoa. Criollo, Forestro and Trinitario. Criollo and Forestro are the natural one, whereas Trinitario is a cross. Among the three different types, Criollo has the best quality cocoa. Okay. Among the three types, do remember, Criollo, Forestro and Trinitario. Criollo has the best quality. Okay, this Charolla wilt is a physiological disorder, that means early wilt or early falling down of a drupe, okay, or a capsule or a pod. Then here in case of cocoa, this is the point you have to remember. Okay, this has to be corrected. In most of the cases, you see the sporophytic self-incompatibility. Cocoa is purely a gametophytic self-incompatibility. Okay, gametophytic, self-compatible. Don't get confused, because in most of the cases in your instant and in your blasters, it's clearly mentioned it is a sporophytic self-compatibility. No, it is a gametophytic self-compatibility. If you want, if I want to be more clear enough to this point, I just want to say, if you have once the pollination takes place, there will be a formation of the pollen tube. The pollen for pollen passes through the pollen tube and reaches the embryo but their female gametes or a female structure fails to mate with the male gametes. Hence, it is a gametophytic self-incompatibility. It is not a sporophytic self-incompatibility. Okay. Cryolo, forest, and tinnitario, right? So among them, cryolo has the best quality, followed by the forest. The tinnitario is a cross between these two. Cryolo crossed with forestro is the tinnitario. Cryolo crossed with the forestro is tinnitario. Okay. There are two subspecies in case of Theobroma coccova. One is Theobroma coccova subspecies coccova. Another one is Theobroma coccova subspecies Sparrowcarpa. Okay. In case of Theobroma coccova, we have two subclasses. One is Theobroma coccova subspecies coccova, another one is Theobroma coccova subspecies Sparrowcarpa. Okay, you must also remember the name Sparrowcarpa. Coming to the pod differentiation, this is very much important. You must remember in case of Cryolo, Forestro, Trinitario, the pod differentiation is, in case of Cryolo, Cryolo parts are yellow color. Are they red color in nature, and they have the best quality. Okay, yellow or red color, and they have the best quality. One point. And the second point is, in case of forestro crops, forestro crops are whitish green color in early stages, and they are converted into yellow color. So green to yellow, whereas cryolo is purple to yellow. Clear? Or a red to yellow. That is a major difference. One point. Among the three different types grown, among the three different types of cocoa, the generally grown cocoa is forestro type. Okay, don't forget, don't get confused. Cryolo has the best quality, same as in case of coffee. Arabica has the best quality, but generally in the larger area, for robusta is grown. Same here also. Cryolo
has the best quality. What is the color, sir?
Yeah, I'll repeat it once again. The best quality is in case of cryolo, but the best quality is in case of cocoa, and the generally grown is the forestro type. You were asking about the colors. Okay. In case of cryolo, the color will be reddish purple color, and they turn into yellow color. Okay, in case of cryolo. Whereas in case of forestro, the color will be greenish color or a whitish green color, and they turn into yellow color. Clear? Okay. Two points we have differentiated now. The third point is cryolo has predominant beaks and the furrows between the, it is a pod, right? If you see a pod or if you see a capsule or ochre, you can see the furrows, right? So there are furrows. There is a predominant furrow in case of cryolo, whereas in case, okay, the seed viability, you remember, okay, the seed viability in case of cocoa is 1 week. So the seed viability in case of cocoa is 1 week. Several hybrids, no need to remembering all of them, but do remember varietal name is Whittle Cocoa Hybrid 1, Whittle Cocoa Hybrid 2, Whittle Cocoa Hybrid 3, and 4. There are 4 hybrids from the Whittle. We have different types of pruning here in case of cocoa, that is very much important. The one important type of pruning is formation pruning. The formation pruning, sanitary pruning, and structural pruning. Okay, we will talk about the formation pruning. What is formation pruning? That is majorly done in an ink plant. That means if I say about the ink plant, there generally it is maintained for the jarcut type. See, until unless your chupon is restricted, the jarcut formation will be very less, right? So you have to restrict the chupon height for about 1.5 to 2 meters, around 1 to 1.5, around 2 meters, you need to restrict the, okay? Then you have the formation pruning, that's what I was saying, it's mainly done in case of young plants, okay? And the second pruning is called a structural pruning, or it is called a, another one is called as sanitary pruning. As the name indicates, structural pruning means we remove all the unnecessary branches or the unnecessary or diseased branches or shoots from the plant. clear with a structural pruning or a sanitary pruning. Okay, and then we have it is called a sanitary pruning. We remove, sanitary means we are making the plant free, that means removing the disease, removing the unwanted shoots from the plant. And the next pruning is called a structural pruning. Structural pruning, as the name gives, we are giving the shape to the plant. So these are the different types of pruning. One is structural pruning, one is sanitary pruning, one is formation pruning. Formation pruning is done in the young plants to give the height of for jarket formation. And then we have structural pruning, that is generally done in case to remove the diseased and unnecessary shoots. And then we have the structural pruning, that is due to shape of the plant. This is all about the importance in case of cocoa. So remember this. The next important crop is,
sir, in which the predominant furrows are seen, sir?
Criolla.
In forest, sir?
Sorry?
In forest, sir?
They have a smooth surface. No, they have a very less furrows when compared to the Criolla types. Criolla types are deep furrows, whereas forest types are smoother surfaces.
Sir, will you please
seed viability of cocoa?
One week.
Okay.
Sir, will you please repeat the structural pruning and sanitary pruning?
Yeah. In case of structural pruning and the sanitary pruning, as the name indicates, what is sanitary? We are making the plants free from diseases and unwanted shoots and other branches. That means if a plant, it has a higher amount of diseases, it has a higher amount of unwanted branches, it has a more number of fran branches, then we need to cut them, right? We need to prune them. That is called as sanitary pruning. We are making it sanitization. We are using it to release the unwanted branches. That is sanitization or a sanitary pruning. Whereas in case of structural pruning, as the name indicates, you are giving a particular shape to the plant. The plant may grow, if any plant, if you leave without any pruning, it may grow according to its nature, right? We want the plant to be in a good manner, or we want the plant should be in a particular shape and structure. So that is called a structural pruning. Giving shape and structure to the plant is called structural pruning, whereas removing the disease and unwanted shoots are called as sanitary pruning. These are the important pruning. I just explained to you because if at all they ask any questions around this, you must be able to answer this.
Okay. So formative pruning is to maintain jarket branches, sir?
Yeah, formative pruning is maintained to jarket branches. Indirectly, if you are maintaining the jarket branches, means what does it mean? It means that you are maintaining the height of the chupon, right? If you want the chupon should be from this side, then you need to cut it here. If you want the chupon from this side, then you need to cut it at that stage. That is the formation. One crop we will see, other crops are not much more important. We will see the another beverage crop. We have seen coffee, we have seen cocoa, we have to see one more important beverage crop, that is tea. Okay, tea, here in case of tea, what you have to remember is tea is a queen of beverages. King also helps her. It's the queen of beverages. 2n = 30. Camellia sinensis belongs to family Camelliaceae or Teaceae. It was introduced to India, right? It was introduced to India. This point you can clearly notice in case of your glossus, I hope so. Robert Tad, it was introduced from China in the year 1980. Okay. The harvesting stages is one apical bud under two leaves. That is what we call it as, right? One bud under two leaves is a particular stage of harvesting. Single node cutting is a propagation materials followed. And then these are the different cultivars. What you have to remember in case of cultivars is their particular characters. Just remembering the name is not so important. Here what you have to remember is Jairam is called as Upasi 2. So Jairam is called as Upasi 2. That is for higher all the elevations. Tea is grown in the different elevations based on the variety. So this Jairam is suitable for all the elevations. Okay. And it is drought tolerance. Jairam is drought tolerance. Okay. But the outstanding variety for a drought, her hardiness is Pandian. Okay. Upasi 10 is an outstanding variety which is resistant to drought. It is an hardy one. This is resistant to drought. This is a hardy tree. I'm sorry, shrub. Then one more variety that you have to remember is Atre. It is suitable for high pH zone. Okay, high pH zone. Atre is suitable for high pH zone, whereas Upasi 10 Pandian is suitable for high drought prone areas. Clear?
Sir, Atre for?
Atre for high pH zones. And these are all just an fancy questions. 50% of the women works in the tea industry are women. Okay. And you have to also remember the best source of nitrogen in case of tea, that is sulfate of ammonia or ammonium sulfates. Okay. One more point you have to remember is tea is a calcifuge crop. What does it mean? What is calcifuge? You might have studied that. Tea is a calcifuge crop. What does it mean?
So it requires less amount of calcium.
It is calcium hating plant. It requires lesser amount of calcium. Hence, we are going for sulfate. These sulfates create the acidity, right? These sulfates create the soil to become much more acidity, or they create the soil to become easier availability of the plants. And these are the important points. Upasi is established in the year 1893. This you have to remember. Okay, Union. Something there, something you have forgotten the full form. Okay. And latest form of chroming is skipping. Skipping you might be knowing that everywhere it has been asked. Okay. And then important points in case of tea is we have different types of pruning. Okay. This pruning is very much important, and few terminologies here in case of pruning. Just remember them, and anything related to that is related to tea. The one important terminology is centering. Okay. Centering. What is centering? As the name indicates, removing the growing top leaves of 8 to 10 mature leaves. Okay, that means in the center portion, we need to make the plant feel free so that we are making centering. Centering, you have to remember, that is related to tea, one point. And the second one is rejuvenation pruning. Rejuvenation pruning is the height, you have to remember with the different pruning heights. Okay, pruning methods and the height you have to remember. Rejuvenation pruning means the height of the pruning will be 20 centimeter from the ground. Whereas in case of 20 to 30 centimeter, in case of rejuvenation, that means we are rejuvenating only from the ground. From 20 to 30 centimeter, we are cutting whole plant so that the plant rejuvenates. Okay, plant can come into new flushes. And next we have the hard pruning. Hard pruning is generally a formative one. That means in order to give a shape or in order to give a structure to the plant, that is 30 to 45 centimeter. Hard pruning is for 30 to 45 centimeter. Then we have medium pruning. As the name goes on, the pruning intensity and the pruning depth also reduces. And then we have medium pruning, that is 45 to 60 centimeter. Okay, from the above, that means we are going till the upper most portion. Then we have the light pruning. This is very much important. Light pruning is generally followed in tea at a height of 60 to 65 centimeter. Okay, light pruning is generally followed in tea at a height of 60 to 65 centimeter. Then we have the lightest form of tea, lightest form of pruning, that is called as skipping. We have the lightest form of pruning, that is skipping, and the height is more than 65 centimeter.
So centering.
Centering is nothing but removing the top growing leaves, okay, in and around the bush. For example, if a tea bush is like this, then if at all there are some crisscross bushes that are growing in the center of the tree, so that the light penetration should be easy to the depth of the plant, right? Only the upper portion will produce with a good quality tea leaves. So in order to do the centering, the mature leaves of 8 to 9, because mature leaves are not at all in value, because we want two leaf and a bud, that means a younger leaf and a bud, right? So if at all there are mature leaves on the top in the center, we need to remove them. That is called a center. Tipping height, tipping material, all these are related to tea. What is tipping? Remove the terminal portion. If you pluck it, that is called as tipping. What is tipping height? The height at which you pluck it. It's called as tipping height. What is tipping material? The material that is tipped off. That means the material which you take it out is called as tipping material. Tipping material, tipping height, and tipping. These three words are related to tea. There is one more terminology, very peculiar, and I just wanted to say this. Okay, you all know that is CTC. Okay, what is CTC? Don't get confused. It is cutting, tearing, and curling. Don't get confused with the curling, tearing, and cutting, and all those things. The options will be with the mashup things. So you just remember CTC means cutting, tearing, and curling. Okay, and the tea processing is also very much important. Tea processing is also very much important. The first step in case of tea processing is withering. Okay, the first step is withering. Withering is done to reduce the moisture content, and the second step is rolling. Rolling is done for the formation of enzymes responsible for the flavors. Rolling is the major step which includes the tea flavors. Which are the flavor compounds in case of tea? Which are the polyphenols which are responsible for flavor in case of tea? They are
tea flavors and tea arginines.
Yeah, they are theophyllins and T-arbugins, right? So they are formed during the rolling process. So theophyllins and T-arbugins are responsible for the flavor and color. So they are formed during the rolling process. We must remember in which process they are formed, in the rolling process. It's the second process. After rolling, then we go
after roll.
Yeah. After rolling, then we go for the dry. Why we should dry? Once the withering and then the rolling takes place, we must dry the tea leaves. That is called as, that is a process where we call the drying. This is all about the major process. Okay. And then we have two different grades, PK and dust. These are related to tea. Pico is more than 8 square per inch. That means bigger tea leaf. Whereas we have one more grade in case of apple also, right? Something called PK or something, Pico or something. You must remembering that. That's also important. And what I was saying is, in case of dust also, there are two, three types of dust. Dust 1, dust 2, dust 3. All these things are related to tea. Okay. Don't get too deep into it, but these are related to tea. Then we are coming into two important terminologies in case of tea processing. That is oolong tea, or it is called as black, some other tea is called as black tea, some is called as green tea. So what is the major between all these things? In case of black tea, whatever tea that you get in your home is called as black tea. Why it is called as black tea? There involves a process called fermentation. Fermentation process includes this theobromins, theophyllins, and due to the fermentation, the coloring and taste enhances. Okay, that is the fermentation process. In case of black tea, we have a fermentation process. So you must remember, black tea has a fermentation process. Green tea is health benefit. Why it is health benefit? It does not have the fermentation process. Green tea does not include fermentation process in the tea processing chain. And then we have another method called as, and then we have another terminology called as oolong tea. It is called a semi-processed tree, or it's called a semi-fermented tree. That is oolong tea. These are the different terminologies related to the tea processing.
Sir, is saline and alkaline soil are same, or sir, or both are different?
Saline and alkaline. For if I have to say, first comes the saline and then comes the alkaline. If the pH goes above 7, then it is a saline soil. If the pH goes above 8 or 9, then it is called as alkali soil. As per my knowledge goes, if at all you want any clarification, I can give it by looking into some material. But what I feel is, so saline soil is which has something sodicity percentage, whereas alkali soil has a higher amount of EC percentage, something like that. We need to look into it. I forgot.
Okay, sir.
Sir, can you repeat the grades in tea?
Tea grades you want, huh? Okay, we have different types of grades. Okay, for your information, the grade is like flower pique. P-E-K-O-E. P-K, there are pico fannings, pico flyings, and all those things. So I just mentioned only two words in that. One is pique, another one is dust. Because in case of dust also, we have fine dust, we have super dust, and there are 10 to 7 grades. So all those grades remembering is not so much important. What you have to remember is pique and dust are related to tea processing. Okay, and in case of tea processing, the withering process is the first, rolling process is the second. The chain is very much important. Withering is the first, rolling is the second. Fermentation is the third process, drying is the fourth process. Clear? Withering, rolling, fermentation. If you skip this fermentation process, if I skip this fermentation process, then it becomes the green tea. Okay, if I include this fermentation process, then it becomes a black. Okay, fermentation process is generally done for 1 to 2 hours. It improves the quality of the tea. It improves the quality of the tea.
Okay.
These are the major farming. We have talked about farms. We have talked about beverages. We are left with rubber and cashew, I hope so, that you can go through. That's not so much important. In case of rubber and cashew also, we have gone through cocoa, we have gone through tea. Okay. This is all about your plantation spices, medicine, aromatics.
Sir, can you list the pruning techniques, sir? Tea.
Pruning techniques in?
List, just okay. List about.
One is, yeah, one is rejuvenation pruning. Okay. Have you taken that? One is rejuvenation pruning, another one is hard pruning, another one is medium pruning, another one is light pruning, and the lightest form of pruning is skipping, last one. There are 5 pruning types, okay? One is rejuvenation pruning, hard pruning, medium pruning, light pruning, and the skipping, okay? 20 centimeter, 30 centimeter, 45 centimeter, 60 centimeter, above 65 centimeter, okay?
Sir, sporophytic incompatibility, sir. What is pain?
Yeah, actually, that's what I was saying. In case of gametophytic cell incompatibility, what happens? The gamete fails to fuse with each other. That means here you can clearly say in cocoa, immediately after the pollination, there is the formation of pollen tube, right? After the formation of pollination, there is a formation of pollen tube. Once the pollen enters to the pollen tube, it should read the gamete, right? It should read the embryo sac, right? It reaches the embryo sac, but it is to mate with the female gamete. That's why it becomes a gametophytic. It is involved in the process, right? So it becomes gametophytic. If at all the incompatibility is other than this sector, gametes. If at all it is from other than. In case of mango, we have sporophyte, right? In case of mango, what happens? They without the formation of pollen tube, without the passing of gamete, the incompatibility happens. That is called a sporophytic. Without the involvement of any gametes or without the involvement of any sexual characters, that is called a gametophytic. Sporophytic. Here, in case of cocoa, it is gametophytic. In most of the books, it is given sporophytic. But if you refer a standard textbook, there we can clearly find it has given gametophytic with an explanation.
Okay, thank you.
This is all about the plantation spices medicinal aromatic. I hope I would try to cover much more information. This is much sufficient for you guys for your JRF examination point, because there will be hardly a 5 or 6 questions. But 5 or 6 questions, you need to attend them and you need to make sure that you can get the score from it, because they are very easy one. Sometimes they are not so hard. But whatever in-depth information I have given, that might be useful for your higher education studies or maybe.
Sir, Kalipak and Kotapak.
Kalipak and Kotapak, yeah. They are the two types of processing in case of Arakanan. As the name indicates, Kotapak means they are generally done in case of maturement of 8 to 9 months old. Kotapak is also called as chali. Okay, that means mature nuts, you directly harvest them, you mix with the chali, the liquid, and then you dry. That is chali or Kotapak. In case of Kalipak, it is generally done in tender nuts, about 6 to 7 months next. So you make a small pieces of it, then you go for a Kalipak. Clear? Any doubts, any questions to be answered?
Sir, can you list the hybrids in coconut, sir?
Hybrids in coconut you need, okay, I can list you. I'll look into it and I'll list. Or else I can send you the notes of them, because there are so many hybrids and it's very difficult for you to remember also. But I can give you a list of them. And if you are so much interested in this, I can even say the list also. One is Chandrashankara. Okay. Chandrashankara is a cross between COD into WCT. Chandrashankara. Second one is Kerashankara. Kerashankara is the ulta of Chandrashankara. Okay. Kera means first parent always will be female, is WCT. So WCT cross with COD. Then we have Chandralaksha. Chandralaksha is LCT into COD. Okay. Yeah, it becomes very difficult. I will just make a photocopy of this and I will put it in your classroom section so that you can make a note of this. There are still many more varieties.
Okay.
Say that you will be full conclusion.
Sir?
Yes, please. Yeah.
Sir, in oil palm processing, why we remove lipase?
The lipase is the enzyme which makes those oil, that means it degrades or it deactivates. If you deactivate the lipase enzyme, that is best, because it directly affects the saturation point. We need unsaturated fatty acids, right? It becomes the saturated fatty acid, so the quality of the oil will be deteriorated. So in order to overcome that, the lipase activity has to be ready. The lipase is the black agent, so you have to stop it by, which is the agent that we method we stop the lipase by, stabilization, right? That we have to remember, because they deteriorate the quality of the oil. They make the browning and they deteriorate the quality.
So what is palm oil?
Is the oil which is extracted from the palm oil, oil palm, okay, which is extracted from the pulp of the oil palm. That is palm oil.
So kernel extracted oil, it is different, sir.
Kernel oil, yeah, it is different. If you see a palm oil or oil palm, we have a kernel and a pulp. It is a kernel, we have a pulp. If you extract the oil from the pulp, then it is called as palm oil. If you extract the oil from the kernel, that is called as kernel oil. It is 2%.
Sir, which is the quality higher? Which has the higher quality, sir?
The quality was the pulp is the better, because it has a palmitic acid, whereas this kernel oil has the lauric acid. It has a very lower concentration also.
Okay, sir. Sir, can you explain about rubber, sir?
Rubber, you... I will send you that notes.
Yes, sir.
I have. I can put it to here.
Okay.
You can stay also. But almost it's 2 hours now. That's enough. If you go through the rubber, any basic information, that's enough for that. You can put that notes in the classroom section. You can go through it.
Sir, yeah. Is there any difference between crude palm oil and palm oil?
Yeah, crude palm oil is the oil which you extract immediately after pressing. If you press the palm fruits, that is a crude palm oil. From the fresh fruit branches, what I was saying, FFB, if extract the oil, that is the crude palm oil. Once you refine it, then it becomes the edible palm oil. Whatever you consume, that is edible palm oil. Palm oil. When will the session start? No, this is not for me. Transplanting time for three palm once more. Transplanting time. In case of Arakanet, it is 10 to 8, 18 months. Sanket MR, it is in this part, 10 to 18 months. In case of coconut, it is around 9 to 12 months. In case of oil palm, it is around 10 to 14 months. Oil palm, highest oil yielding. Among the different oil yielding crops, it is the highest oil yielding. Okay. Sir, Neera extracted from unopened spathe or spadix. It is spadix. Sir, different between Neera and Toddy. I have told Neera is a not fermented. Toddy is a fermented. Toddy contains 5% alcohol. Okay, any important cultivars of oil palm, we have Dura, Panera, Fisifera. Other than that, we don't have any important cultivars which are derivatives. But among them, Panera is highly grown. Why cocoa changed it from Sterculaceae malusi, that I don't know. You need to ask some botanist why they have changed it. Maybe because of its flower structure or a plant morphology. Seed variability. Variability, I was talking about the viability. It was 1 week. And sir, cocoa is sporophytic. It is gametophytic. Sir, tell about the seed index in Arakanet. Yeah, seed index means it was, I thought it is, it becomes much more. Seed index is nothing but it was given by Bavappa. He was a scientist in CPCRI, I hope. He has given that, it has given a formula to find out the seed index. That means what is the best size of the seed to select. So he has given the height of the palm into 40 and number of leaves, okay, into 40 minus height of the plant. That was given by Bavappa. You remember the seedling index, that is number of leaves in a plant into 40. I don't know why they have selected it, and then the height of the plant. If you get the seedling index, if it is more, then you can select the seedling for transplanting. It is given by Bavappa. Then tell about seedling.
So say the formula, sir.
Sorry,
once again the formula.
Formula,
seedling index,
number of leaves at a time of planting into 40 minus height of the plant. Coupling or scuffling, who is this? Pooja MB, maybe it is scuffling. Scuffling is nothing but the removing of the uprooting, or that means you are disturbing the soil in order to overcome the weeds, or you are making puddling, or you can even say that plowing. Okay. Which nitrogen source in tea, can or ammonium sulfate? Ammonium sulfate and can, both are good enough. But in some textbook you find can, but ammonium based one is best one, because in case of can also we have the same one, right? At the end of tea processing, what is the moisture content present? So the moisture content in the made tea is around 3 to 4%. This is very much important question, a very good question. The moisture content in the tea, made tea, is around 3%. So flavors are formed in rolling or fermentation. Flavors are formed in case of fermentation. The enzymes responsible for flavors are compounds are formed in case of rolling. Are there any rust resistant variety in coffee? The rust resistant is Robusta. Okay, Robusta is rust resistant. Grades in Arakanet: Moti, Jamnagar, Jinni and Srivardhan. Type of tissue which has oil in the oil palm. Mesocarp is the one, right? Okay. Which is the blossom shower? What is the blossom shower in coffee, sir? If I want to explain you about the blossom showers in coffee, coffee flowers actually originates in the month of November, December itself. Okay, in the shoot. If it is a shoot, the flower originates in the November, December itself. But coffee has a particular character of dormancy. The flower gets into a dormancy because of the accumulation of abscisic acid. So up to March, April, May, there will be a dormancy. Once the March, April, coffee is generally grown in high rainfall areas, right? Like in Chikmagalur in this area. In the March, we receive the rainfalls. That is called as blossom shower. What happens to the blossom shower? That dilutes the amount of abscisic acid in the bud so that the flowering becomes easy. Some people also give the blossom shower early in order for an early flowering. And then after 15 to 20 days, you need to give a backing rain. That means the remaining flower also need to be open. That is blossom shower. Okay. So spacing for coconut. Coconut spacing depends upon the dwarf and the tall. Dwarf it is given around 3 to 3 or 4 to 4. In case of tall, it is given 7.5. Harvesting time of coconut, example, bal copra and tender nut. Tender nut is generally harvested at 5 to 6 months, whereas bal copra and nut copra is harvested at 8 to 9 months. What is mean by topping in wet coffee processing? Topping, huh? Wet coffee processing. Wet coffee is nothing but the parchment making. I don't have come across this. I'll just go through this. Harita Vanan, sorry for this. I will come across this. Okay. And the pH of
sir, moisture content in tea
is around 3%. May tea is around 3%. what is EFB, empty bunches, empty fruit bunches in oil palm. That means if the bunch is not having any fruits, it may be an empty fruit bunch. EFB is related to this. Okay, what is clean felling, which is not recommended in coffee? I don't know. What is this? Pooja Ravi Kumar, what is clean felling? If you come across somewhere, you can please send it to me. Sir, is there any special character for Chandragiri coffee? Chandragiri coffee is an Arabica type. What can I say? It is a cross between, I have forgotten the cross. If I want, I need to go back and check. It's an Arabica type, I can say. And some say it has some resistance to leaf rust. Okay. Some races of leaf rust. There are several races of Emilia Vestrastix. There are some resistance of resistance source for Chandragiri. What is attachins are the polyphenols. Phenols, water, whenever you dip the green tea, you get a green color fluid, right? That is because of the catechins. Okay, where we don't have theoclovins and thioarbidins because they lack fermentation process. That is why we have catechins. Seed index in Arakanet, sir, explained. Seed index, as I was saying, it was given by Bhavappa in the year 1970. Number of leaves at the time of planting into 40 minus height of the plant.
Sir, can you tell the high yielding rubber, sir? Rubber variety, sir?
Rubber variety is RRIM 600.
Okay, sir, I know RRII 105, sir, it is correct.
Yeah, that is also one of the best yielding variety. But if you are asked among the RR600 and 105, in India it is generally 105 is generally considered one of the best variety. I was on the best yielding, I was saying that 600, but the best in case of in Indian conditions, it is called as 105 only.
Okay, sir, in the world level it is 600.
Yeah, it is from IM Malaysia, this is from India. And recently there was some information about rubber, the first genetically modified rubber from RRII Kottam, you might be knowing. It includes a gene, it includes the gene which has a chilling tolerance, it can be grown in a northeastern region. Okay.
MNS origin.
MNS origin. MNS origin. MNS origin. MNS origin. It has a resistant gene, okay, that you must remember.
Okay, sir.
Sir, is seed index formula is in Arakanet?
Yeah, it is in Arakanet. It is exclusively in Arakanet.
Scientist name, sir?
Bhavappa. B-A-V-A-P-P-A. It is done, then. Thank you so much. If you have any doubts, you can ask at any time. This is all about the plant.
Species origin of oil palm.
West Africa.
Another origin we have said.
No, that is another species which has what origin, it is called as American oil palm, Ales olifera. Okay, Ales olifera is an American oil palm, whereas this Ales guineensis generally cultivated one is called as the West African palm. It is originated in Africa.
Okay, sir.
Thank you.
Sir, is species of coffee? Coffee ki species?
Coffee ko teen species hai, theek hai? Ek hai robusta, ek hai arabica, ek hai tree coffee. Robusta scientifically Caffea canephora, arabica scientifically Caffea arabica, and tree coffee is Caffea liberica.
Yes, sir.
All these things I have discussed while taking the class. If you have any doubts, you can go back to the recordings.